you. Well, thank you very much. It's an honor to be here tonight and to have the opportunity to open this very interesting conference. And I know we're going to have a very interesting time here over the next few days. And I just have to apologize in advance. I'm getting over a cold, but hopefully I will make it through this lecture. So I want to speak to you today about the idea of man as a geological agent. And specifically the question of where does the Anthropocene concept take us intellectually, scientifically, culturally, politically? There are various answers to that question, and we will hear a number of them over the course of the next few days, but at least some of them are not very pleasant. They include the possibility of the dramatic disruption of our social, political, and economic systems as they prove unable to deal with disruptive climate change. And it's this possibility of a dystopic Anthropocene, of this kind of large-scale disruption, a kind of great disruption to match the great acceleration, which is the subject of my new book with my colleague Eric Conway, which has the very modest title, The Collapse of Western Civilization. The book is a novella. It takes place in the future, in the year 2393, where a historian living in the Second People's Republic of China looks back on our present and asks the question, how is it possible that these people knew so much about what was happening to them, but did so little to stop its negative consequences? So the new book Collapse builds on our previous work in the book Merchants of Doubt, which I'm happy to say has just been released by John Wiley in German, Die Machiavellis der Wissenschaft. And in a way, the new book is a means to restate what was the central argument at the end of Merchants of Doubt, namely that opposition to climate science, opposition to the scientific results about the Anthropocene, is not scientific. It doesn't emerge from within the scientific community. It's not internal scientific dissent, but it's political and ideological. And in the United States in particular, we show in our book that it arises from a fear, an anxiety, that government action to address climate change will lead to a loss of economic liberty and then subsequently to a loss of personal liberty and freedom. And this helps to explain why climate change denial is so much more prevalent in the United States than it is in Europe and elsewhere. Now, in Merchants of Doubt, we argue that this position has a certain kind of tragic irony about it, because the threat of disruptive climate change means that we may see events like catastrophic flooding, hurricanes, typhoons, droughts, wildfires, crop failure, events that in fact invite heavy-handed government intervention, the very sort of intervention that climate change contrarians and deniers most fear and dread. So that is the scenario that we paint in our new book, the idea that in fact disruptive government intervention becomes required by the events that unfold in the years between 2093 and 2393. So what I'd like to do now is just read two short excerpts from the book, and then I'll return to my more conventional academic lecture. But imagine that this is indeed still an academic lecture. It's simply 300 years in the future. We probably have a better sound system. You probably have simultaneous translation going on inside your ear. And we're in China. By 2040, heat waves and droughts were the norm. Control measures such as water and food rationing and Malthusian one-child policies were widely implemented. In wealthy countries, the most hurricane or tornado-prone regions were gradually but steadily depopulated, putting increased social pressure on areas less subject to those hazards. In poor nations, conditions were predictably worse. Rural portions of Africa and Asia began experiencing significant depopulation from out-migration, malnourished-induced disease and infertility, and starvation. Still, sea level had only risen 9 to 15 centimeters around the globe, and coastal populations were largely still intact. Then, in the Northern Hemisphere summer of 2041, unprecedented heat waves scorched the planet, destroying food crops around the globe. Panic ensued, with food riots in virtually every major city. Mass migration of undernourished and dehydrated individuals, coupled with explosive increases in insect populations, led to widespread outbreaks of typhus, cholera, dengue fever, yellow fever, and viral and retroviral agents never before seen. Surging insect populations also destroyed huge swaths of forests in Canada, Indonesia, and Brazil. As social order began to break down in the 2050s, governments were overthrown, particularly in Africa, but also in many parts of Asia and Europe, further decreasing social capacity to deal with increasingly desperate populations. As the great North American desert surged north and east, consuming the high plains and destroying some of the world's most productive farmland, the U.S. government declared martial law to prevent food riots and looting. A few years later, the United States announced plans with Canada for the two nations to begin negotiations towards the creation of the United States of North America to develop an orderly plan for resource sharing and northward population relocation. The European Union announced similar plans for voluntary northward relocation of eligible cities from its southernmost regions to Scandinavia and the United Kingdom. So then our narrator, our historian, goes on to recount some of the other dislocations, including sea level rise, that swamped much of the Netherlands and Bangladesh, and of course were part of the forced relocation of tens or hundreds of millions of people. And then she proceeds to her analysis of what transpired. To the historian studying this tragic period of human history, the most astounding fact is that the victims knew what was happening and why. Indeed, they chronicled it in detail precisely because they knew that fossil fuel combustion was to blame. Historical analysis also shows that Western civilization had the technical know-how and capability to effect an orderly transition to renewable energy, yet the available technologies were not implemented in time. As with all great historical events, there is no easy answer to the question of why this catastrophe occurred, but two key factors stand out. The thesis of this analysis is that Western civilization became trapped in the grip of two inhibiting ideologies, positivism and market fundamentalism. 20th century scientists saw themselves as descendants of an empirical tradition often referred to as positivism, after 19th century French philosopher Auguste Comte, who developed the concept of positive knowledge, as in absolutely positively true. But the overall philosophy is more accurately rendered as Baconianism. This philosophy held that through experience, observation, and experiment, one could gather reliable knowledge about the natural world, and that this knowledge would empower its holder. Experience justified the first part of the philosophy. We have recounted how 20th century scientists anticipated the consequences of climate change. But the second part, that this knowledge would translate into power, proved less accurate. Although billions of dollars were spent on climate research in the late 20th and early 21st centuries, the resulting knowledge had little impact on the crucial economic and technological policies that drove the continued use of fossil fuels. A key attribute of this period was that power did not reside in the hands of those who understood the climate system, but rather in political, economic, and social institutions that had a strong interest in maintaining the use of fossil fuels. Historians have labeled this system the carbon combustion complex, a network of powerful industries comprising fossil fuel producers, industries that served energy companies, such as drilling and oil field service companies and large construction firms, manufacturers whose products relied on inexpensive energy, especially automobiles and aviation, but also aluminum and other forms of smelting and mineral processing, financial institutions that serviced their capital demands, and advertising, public relations, and marketing firms who promoted their products. Maintaining the carbon combustion complex was clearly in the self-interest of these groups, so they cloaked this fact behind a network of so-called think tanks that issued challenges to scientific knowledge they found threatening. Newspapers often quoted these think tank employees as if they were climate researchers, juxtaposing their views against those of epistemologically independent university or government scientists. This practice gave the public the impression that the science was still uncertain, thus undermining the sense that it was time to act. Meanwhile, scientists continued to do science, believing on the one hand that it was inappropriate for them to speak on political questions or to speak in the emotional register required to convey urgency, and on the other, that if they produced abundant and compelling scientific information and explained it calmly and clearly, the world would take steps to avert disaster. So let me return to the present day now and ask the question, so how does this relate to the Anthropocene concept? And what I'd like to do then now is to just talk a little bit about the history of the concept, to consider the question of why scientists themselves resisted this idea when it was first introduced, and then to broaden it to ask the question, why is this idea more broadly threatening? And where does that leave us today? So the Anthropocene concept is often credited to Eugene Sturmer and Paul Crutzen, who first introduced and popularized the term, but the concept, the idea that we were now living in a different age where human impacts were beginning to match the scale and magnitude of geophysical and geological processes, that idea actually goes back quite a bit further. It's by this point, I would say, at least 100 years old. Probably everyone here is familiar with the work of Svante Arrhenius, who's credited with being the first scientist to quantify the impact of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere produced by burning coal. When I was in graduate school, Arrhenius was mainly famous for his contributions to chemical thermodynamics and for the introduction of the notion of an activity constant. And we spent a lot of hours memorizing equations and derivations that came from Svante Arrhenius. So I like him much better now as the hero of the history of climate science for having done the first calculations of the effect of doubling atmospheric carbon dioxide and giving us the first calculations of the Earth's climate sensitivity, namely 1.5 to 4.5 degrees C. Now, Arrhenius was Swedish, so he thought that global warming would be a good thing. The first person to suggest that it might not be a good thing, and also to really investigate the problem in a sustained way, is this man, the British steam engineer Guy Stewart Callender. Jim Fleming, who has written a wonderful biography of Callender, argues that Fleming was in some ways one of the first climate scientists, because he didn't just put this out as an idea, but he really tried to investigate what evidence we might have to support the idea that this might already be happening, in effect to say that we might already be in the Anthropocene. And in 1938, he published a paper in the Quarterly Journal of the Royal Meteorological Society suggesting just that, that the available data showed that there was a detectable increase in carbon dioxide and perhaps a detectable increase in temperature too, although about that he was less certain. But certainly he was making the suggestion that humans were having a discernible impact on the climate system, a suggestion that would be affirmed by the IPCC 50 years later in 1995, 60 years later. The issue was also studied in the United States at the Naval Research Laboratory. Here's one article by a physicist there, E.O. Hurlburt, who in Physical Review wrote a paper again on the question of climate sensitivity. Calculation shows that doubling or tripling the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere increases the average surface temperature by about 4 degrees and 7 degrees, respectively. So here we have the climate sensitivity for doubling at 4 degrees. That's the high end of what the IPCC now gives us. It will be interesting to see what turns out to be the truth in the end. But what we see from this early work is that the basic physics, the basic idea of greenhouse gases altering the radiative properties of the atmosphere, was already in place by the 1930s. People understood, scientists understood, that carbon dioxide was a greenhouse gas whose concentration in the atmosphere had a very strong effect on global climate, and that its concentration was already increasing because of man's combustion of fossil fuels. But I would add to this that I think we can also argue that the basic humanities of the problem was also already in place, because people also understood that the reason this mattered was because human activities could, and maybe would, have a significant impact on the so-called natural world. So the idea that the distinction between the natural world and the man-made world might begin to blur, we see already beginning to be introduced. Now, these men I've just spoke about were not geologists, and they were not necessarily thinking about this in what we could consider geological or physical terms, and certainly they had not yet introduced the idea that we might actually be living in a new geological epoch. But some other people were actually beginning to think about that. And perhaps the most important one for our purposes here tonight is Robert Sherlock, who wrote a very interesting book in 1923 with the title Man as a Geologic Agent. I have a little bit of a personal story here. My first teaching job was in the Earth Sciences Department at Dartmouth College in the United States. And when I took on that job, a member of the faculty had just died a few months before. And one of my colleagues said, you know, a lot of his library is still in his office. Why don't you go see if there's any books you want? Because people knew I was already interested in history of science. And I found this rather unusual book called Man as a Geologic Agent. Years later, when I began to do the work that would lead to the book Merchants of Doubt, I was studying the American scientists who had done the early work on acid rain in the United States, including the work of a man named Noe Johnson, who was the first person to demonstrate the effect of acid precipitation on soils in northern New Hampshire, in the forest, Hubbard Brook Experimental Forest. It was Noe Johnson's copy of this book that I had found at Dartmouth College. So what does this book say? Well, the book was published in 1923. Who was Sherlock? He was a British geologist, the author of several guidebooks to British stratigraphy, and an expert on the Permo-Triassic periods. The foreword to the book was written by Arthur Smith Woodward, who many of you may know as a very famous paleontologist and anatomist. He was president of the Geological Society at one point, a fellow of the Royal Society, and also very famous because he was one of these experts who was taken in by the Piltdown Man hoax. The central argument of Sherlock's book is what we would now call the Anthropocene argument. The argument is that the human impact on the planet now competes with the natural impact. So much so, he argues, that the distinction between the natural and the artificial begins to be difficult to sustain. Sherlock was particularly interested in the human impact on landscapes. He wrote extensive chapters on deforestation, on erosion related to human activities, on quarrying, on the removal of soils and rocks in mining, the construction of dams and harbors that could alter coastlines and river courses. And indeed, he suggested the need for a new science, which he called anthropogeography. But he also included climate. Indeed, the last chapter of his book, as you can see here, is on climate and scenery. Actually, I'm not sure. Do I have a laser pointer here? I don't know if I do or I don't. Well, if you look right in the middle where that arrow is pointing, climate and scenery, he has a section on the atmosphere, the effect of burning coal deposits, effect of vegetation. So he talks about the effect of deforestation on climate and the effect of burning coal. Now, where did Sherlock himself get these ideas from? Well, he cites three sources that have influenced his own thinking. The first is Arrhenius, who we've already discussed. And he explicitly cites Arrhenius, saying, carbon dioxide has a powerful effect on the climate because it has the property of absorbing heat reflected from the ground, which would otherwise be radiated into space. Boy, there's the greenhouse effect in a nutshell. I wish the IPCC, instead of reinventing the wheel, would just take this quotation, because that's probably the pithiest explanation of the greenhouse effect I've ever seen. Arrhenius thought that if the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere were increased threefold, the temperature of the Arctic regions would rise by 8 or 9 degrees C. There you also have a very simple explanation of what we now call the ice albedo feedback that Arrhenius already recognized more than 100 years ago, that the Arctic would warm more rapidly than the rest of the Earth. But Sherlock was also deeply influenced by the American geologist Thomas Crowder Chamberlain. Chamberlain was a very, very prominent, famous geologist, editor of the Journal of Geology, who had proposed a theory to explain the ice ages by fluctuations in carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. And Sherlock wrote, "Chamberlain has worked out along these lines an explanation of the recurring glacial and tropical periods of the past. He thinks that the Permian glaciation was a consequence of the removal from the atmosphere of the vast mass of carbon locked up by animals and plants in the forms of limestone and coal during the Carboniferous period. Assuming his hypothesis is correct, we may reasonably consider the result of a reversal of this process." So Sherlock already recognizes the essential point here that would later be emphasized by people like Roger Revelle, that natural processes had stored huge amounts of carbon in the Carboniferous period of geological time in the form of coal deposits and limestone, and now we were reversing that storage, taking all that stored carbon and bringing it back to the atmosphere. And that, he argued, could have significant consequences. And if the removal of the carbon in the Carboniferous had contributed to glaciation in the Permian period, then we could reasonably conclude that the opposite would occur now, that now we're putting this carbon back, and that would lead to the end of the Pleistocene and bring us into a new tropical period. Now, Sherlock was also influenced by a third thinker. That was George Perkin Marsh, who, a very interesting person, an American paleontologist, philologist, linguist, diplomat, conservationist, author, very interesting, diverse thinker, sometimes in the United States credited as being the first American conservationist because he was one of the first people to really call attention to the huge amounts of deforestation that were taking place in the United States. And he talked about that particularly in a book called The Earth as Modified by Human Action, where he discussed the possibility that the climate system could be influenced by deforestation because the removal of these trees would reduce the amount of CO2 removed from the atmosphere. And because if these trees were burned, that CO2 would be returned to the atmosphere. So Sherlock describes Marsh as being mainly devoted to the meteorological effects of forests and the results of their destruction by man. Now, historian James Fleming has written extensively about theories of climate change in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, and one of the things that he stresses is that carbon dioxide theories of climate were quite widely discussed in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. That is to say, there was a recognition of increasing human impact. So we might ask the question then, why did these ideas not gain greater traction? Why did scientists not begin a vigorous research program investigating some of these issues that Arrhenius and Marsh and Chamberlain and Sherlock had raised? They seem like pretty major questions. So why did the idea not gain intellectual traction? Well, Sherlock himself realizes that he has an uphill battle. And one reason he gives is because he argues that the idea of an accelerating human impact, and he uses the word accelerating, and he stresses the idea of the acceleration, is because it challenges the geological principle of uniformitarianism. He writes, "The school founded by Sir James Hutton and supported by Sir Charles Lyell was intended to prove that the forces of nature had always acted at approximately the same rate as the present and were fully competent to produce all the results known to geologists given sufficient time. Under Lyell's powerful influence, the uniformitarians prevailed over the catastrophists and until recently seemed to be completely victorious." So he's hoping that there could be a change, but he's saying that the power of the uniformitarian model, that what's happened in the past has been caused by the same processes as are still operating at present and at the same rate, that idea stands in the way of recognizing the impact of human activities. The principle of uniformitarianism became the dominant philosophy of geology in the Anglophone world, and to some extent the rest as well, although it didn't have as strong an impact in France and Germany and Italy as it did in England and Scotland and the United States. And this was, as Sherlock says, in part because of Lyell's influence, but I think as a historian, I would say even more so because of Darwin. Because Darwin's theory of the origin of species by natural selection depended upon the principle of uniformitarianism, and he said so himself in many places in his work. Darwin's theory was based on the assumption that tiny, tiny changes produced by natural selection, changes that we might not be able to observe during the course of a human lifetime, would, over the vastness of geological time, lead to new species, the formation of new species and the extinction of former ones. So uniformitarianism was central to how Darwin thought natural selection could produce new species given enough time. Darwin's success was read backwards by later generations of geologists and biologists as Lyell and Hutton's success. That is to say, people retrospectively credited Lyell and Hutton with a degree of acceptance that they had not actually had in their own lifetimes. And indeed, there was a vigorous argument in the mid-19th century about whether or not Lyell's ideas even made any sense. In France, it wasn't called uniformitarianism. Some of you may know it was actually called actualism, because the French accepted the methodological elements of the theory that we should try to witness processes that are actually happening around us and use that as a methodological principle, but we should not necessarily assume that the rates of change in the past or the rates at which those processes took place were necessarily the same. So they were actualists without being uniformitarians. But the argument goes even deeper and fuller, especially again in the Anglophone world. As historians Stephen Jay Gould and Martin Rudwick have noted, generations of geologists, some of whom are probably in this room tonight, were taught that the most important contribution of geology to the world, to thinking in general, the contribution of geology as a science that was unique and distinct and different from the contributions of physics or chemistry or biology, was that we geologists had demonstrated man's insignificance. That we had proven that man was just this tiny, 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 tiny thing when compared to geological time and the magnitude of geophysical forces. And there were so many different metaphors used to imprint this concept on us, but I'll give you the one that I remember most from my own education, which was that our textbooks were always filled with some analogy to try to impress upon us how insignificant man really was. And actually, there's two that I remember very clearly. One was to imagine geological time as a clock. And the existence, the appearance of man takes place in less than the final second of the final minute of the final hour of that day. Boom, that's us. Or another metaphor was sometimes, imagine geological time as your arm outstretched. And now, how large is the history of all of mankind in that? Well, take a nail file and just swipe it once against the edge of your nails and your outstretched fingers. You've just wiped out all of human history. Now, Freud famously argued that Copernicus's great but also distressing and troubling move was to displace man from the center of the universe, but we geologists boasted about the fact that we had displaced man from the center of the earth. So part of what it meant to be a geologist in the 20th century was to exclude consideration of human impacts. Not even just to exclude them, but to dismiss them as insignificant. And to the extent that they did exist, to the extent that they might be of interest, say in history or archaeology, well, for earth sciences ended where human impacts begin. And I think you see this most clearly in archaeology. When I was first studying geology, my mother used to tell neighbors and friends that I had gone on digs. It's like, no, Mom, that's archaeologists. Geologists don't go on digs, right? So as soon as we would see evidence of human civilization, human settlement, we handed it over to the archaeologists or maybe the physical anthropologists. Now, Sherlock in his work suggested a point that now seems obvious. There are indications, he wrote, that the doctrine of uniformity has been carried too far. Man has exaggerated the steadiness of nature. A succession of small catastrophes alternating with steady periods, he argues, is the truer idea. So you see here him wanting to reintroduce the idea of catastrophe as a reasonable physical proposition. Now, geological catastrophes, of course, were distinct from social and political catastrophes. The early geological catastrophists did not necessarily believe that geological catastrophes were bad. Most, in fact, viewed them as morally neutral, natural phenomena. So an earthquake or a volcano is a catastrophe from a geological standpoint, but it's not necessarily a catastrophe from a human impact. That would depend on whether or not people were in the path of the volcano. But as Voltaire realized and wrote about in Candide, the geological and the political could easily overlap, and a catastrophic earthquake in a place like Lisbon could easily become a political and social catastrophe as well, challenging the idea that this is the best of all possible worlds. So the negative connotations, the culturally negative implications of catastrophe were not wholly inappropriate. And this, of course, leads to the second reason why people have resisted the idea. As Woodward noted in his introduction to the book, the human impact on the globe is not necessarily good. Woodward wrote, damming a river can alter the erosive powers of certain sections of its upper courses, or as hydrologists sometimes like to say it now, upstream dams create downstream floods. That's a well-known maxim in hydrology. Harbor works and protective structures on one part of the coast may have disastrous effects on another part, and is not always possible to predict what these effects will be. And this was particularly true, Woodward argued, for climate. So he concluded his foreword, the very conclusion to this book on man's impact is about climate. Most interesting of all, he writes, is the question whether man, by his prodigious combustion of coal and other carbonaceous substances, is producing more carbonic acid than can be eliminated by ordinary natural processes. If this production is excessive, the result eventually may be an unwelcome change in his atmospheric surrounding. Man may be approaching a stage where he should pause to consider whether his use and alteration of the crust of the earth itself are for future as well as present advantage. So just pause and think about it. Now, so I think what this shows is the essential point I wish to make tonight. The Anthropocene challenged dominant 19th and 20th century ideals of improvement. The assumption that human activities were improving the globe, improving the earth, improving the world around us, is challenged by the notion of the Anthropocene. It challenges our belief in progress. Sherlock acknowledged this, but he had an answer for that. He said, don't be worried, because man's activities are not consistent, particularly in their direction. It is evident, he wrote, that man's geological work varies frequently, and that he undoes today much that was done yesterday, thereby diminishing his net activities. While his geological activities grow in power, they are forever changing their direction. So he argues we can't do too much harm because we're too inconsistent. But today we know that, sadly, we're actually much more consistent than Sherlock imagined. Many of our activities are highly directional. More use of resources, more damming of rivers, more carbon dioxide put into the atmosphere. And probably in most cases, maybe not all, but in many at least, net negative. And virtually all scientists know this and accept it. So today our challenge is not scientific, as nearly all Earth scientists accept the reality of anthropogenic climate change, and as we will hear more of in the next few days, geologists are now formally considering the Anthropocene as an addition to geological nomenclature and as an epoch in the geologic timescale. And I want to propose that if they do that, and if there are subdivisions of the Anthropocene, at least one of them should be the Sherlockian. Today, our challenge is not scientific, it's economic and technical, as our use of fossil fuels and production of greenhouse gases continues to increase even as we speak. In fact, one of the things I find most shocking of all the statistics and data that we could look at, more than half of all greenhouse gas emissions to the atmosphere have occurred since 1988, since the creation of the IPCC, since Jim Hansen testified in the US Congress that climate change was underway. So we have continued to increase our rate of acceleration, to accelerate the acceleration, even as we have known that this was going on. Our challenge is also political, particularly in the United States, but elsewhere as well, as the carbon combustion complex, as my Chinese historian puts it, continues to attack scientists like Jim Hansen and Michael Mann, to drive from office political leaders who want to act on climate change, and most important, to block meaningful policy action. And it's ideological and conceptual. And I would like to argue, not as Andrew Revkin has suggested, because we've fallen into self-loathing. Maybe there's some of that here and there, but I don't see that as primary. But because the reality of the Anthropocene is that a good deal of our impact is not good. It's net negative. And because we have to accept that some of our key ideas and concepts are inadequate. Because we don't know how to fix this. And I think this crucial idea that some of our key ideas are not adequate, that are not up to the task, is part of what this meeting invites us to consider. To consider the possibility of some new ideas, some things that maybe we have not yet thought about. And this, I think, is our most difficult challenge. It's not a scientific challenge, it's a conceptual challenge. The recognition that some of our key ideas and concepts are inadequate, and we have yet to figure out what to replace them with. To say that we matter could be a good thing. We are not trivial. We're not just specks of dust in a blind, mindless universe. But the problem is that our impact is threatening our own health, our prosperity, and our well-being. And it's also threatening the basis of the world economy and the world's prosperity so far as it goes, because all of that great acceleration drove the wealth of the North and also the poverty of the South. And this, I would argue, is the fundamental basis of a good deal of American denialism, because climate change threatens our belief in free market economics, it threatens our faith in Adam Smith's invisible hand, and it undermines our belief in the magic of the marketplace. And I use the word faith and belief advisedly. And this is frightening because we don't know what to replace it with. And the only alternative that most Americans can imagine is communism. We Americans sometimes, we invented Hollywood, but we sometimes have a staggering lack of imagination. As Frederick Jameson has put it, we find it easier to imagine the end of the world than the end of capitalism. And to that, I have to plead guilty. But I do want to say, and be on record as saying, lest I be accused of being a communist, I do not believe that we necessarily need to imagine the end of capitalism, but we do need to escape from our belief in the magic of the marketplace. So I would quote a different thinker here and say, John Maynard Keynes once said that the difficulty lies not so much in developing new ideas, as escaping from old ones. But I think right now we need to do both. So I want to end then just with one more short reading from the book, and then at that point say goodnight to you, and you can go have a stiff drink. So this comes then from the final section of the book, which is entitled Market Failure. The ultimate irony of this story was that neoliberalism, meant to ensure individual freedom above all, led eventually to a situation that necessitated large-scale government intervention. Classical liberalism was centered on the idea of individual liberty, and in the 18th century, most individuals had precious little of it, economic or otherwise. But by the mid-20th century, this situation had changed dramatically. Slavery was formally outlawed in the 19th century, and monarchies and other forms of empire were increasingly replaced by various forms of liberal democracy. In the West, individual freedoms, both formal and informal, probably peaked around the time that Friedrich von Hayek was writing, or shortly thereafter. By the end of the 20th century, Western citizens still held the formal rights of voting, various forms of free thought and expression, and freedom of employment and travel. But actionable freedom was decreasing, first as economic power was increasingly concentrated in a tiny elite, who came to be known as the 1%, and then in a political elite propelled to power as climate crisis forced dramatic interventions to relocate citizens displaced by sea level rise and desertification, to contain contagion, and to prevent mass famine. And so, the development that the neoliberals most dreaded, centralized government and loss of personal choice, was rendered essential by the very policies that they had put in place. Thank you very much.